Hi, my name is Robert Feranek, I'm from FEDEVEL Academy, and in this video we are going to speak about if to buy footprint or not, and what are the advantages, what you may think about, and how it works. Okay, so what you may get, what you can adjust, how you can import this footprint, where you can import this, all these kind of things, and also how much it costs. So now many people may think like, oh, but you keep saying everybody should create their own footprints by themselves and, you know, these kind of things. And the truth is, I really believe every engineer should know how to create footprints, but there may be some situations when buying footprints can save you some time, and it can also speed up your project, and maybe it's even cheaper than if you would be creating the footprint by yourself. So let's have a look at all these kind of things, why I actually bought the footprint and why I have not created the footprint by myself, and also why I paid for the footprint, why I have not just downloaded the footprint for free somewhere from internet. So here is the video, I hope you will like it, and let's start. The main reason why I bought the footprint is this IPC standard 7351C. I'm not sure if it exists yet, but I found this document which describes some changes. And because I'm creating a new library, I wanted to start with a proper footprints, the footprints what will follow the latest standards. And as you can see, this is one of the things what was interesting for me. All the shape of the paths, it started with standard rectangular paths. Then there was a new IPC standard which was recommending these oblong shapes of the paths. And in this new IPC 7351C standard, they just recommend something like this. So I wanted to use the footprints which will have the paths with these rounded corners. So I started looking how I could create these footprints, and also I started looking for this standard. I wanted to know more what else is different, what else I should follow, and I couldn't really find much information about this on internet. As I said, I'm not sure if it was released, if it already exists, and if it exists, you probably need to pay for this standard, which then you can download, and then you may need to spend like a lot of time trying to read it and figure out what you need to use in your footprints. And I really don't have this kind of time, so I wanted something what I could use very quickly. And first idea what I wanted to try was Altium Designer IPC Wizard. Yeah, and this one, this IPC Wizard in Altium, it only creates this kind of paths. So I was quite sure it's not following this C standard. Then I went to internet, I tried to download some free footprints. I went to Snap EDA, I went to all the kind of different websites, and none of them was creating this kind of paths. And then I found this document, and then I found this document was created by Tom from PCBLibraries.com. And when I went to this website, PCBLibraries.com, I found out they actually provide the kind of footprints which really follow these new IPCC recommendations. And that is one of the main reasons why I decided, okay, I don't want to spend my time reading this document. I don't want to spend money buying this document. I don't really have time for all this. I just need the footprints. So I decided I'm going to buy the footprints. And also the reason why I decided to buy this footprint is because they are not expensive. I will show you how much it costs. Go to PCB Library's website, click on Compare Editions, or go directly on this URL, pcblibraries.com products compare, and let's have a look what they have here. The website is quite hard to understand. I spent quite some time to actually figure out how it works. As you can see, they have like different number of options, and you need to download some software to be able to actually use the footprints. So I spent some time trying to figure out how it works. I almost give up, I need to tell you. I almost give up and I almost went away, but I came back because I really needed the footprints. So basically, to make it very simple, we are going to use this option which is here. For this option, we need to download this builder software. The software is used to open the library which you will buy from them. This software is basically used to open the footprint, what you will buy or what they will create for you. And then through this software, you will export the footprint into your own CAD system. And there are some other options what you can do in the builder. It is actually quite a useful way how you can export footprints for your CAD system. You will see. So if you go for this option, you download this software for free, and then there are two things. So if the footprint what you need already, or if the component what you need already exists in PCB Libraries library, then you only pay $1 or $2 to download this footprint from their library. And then once you download this file, then you open it in the builder and then you export it into your CAD system. And I need to say they have quite a lot of components in their library, and if you cannot really find the exact component what you need, very often you can just delete last characters. You can find something similar. You can find the footprint maybe not for your exact component, but for similar component with same footprint. So basically for my project, I only needed to create 3 custom footprints. All the other components for my project, I was able to find in the database and download them for $1 or $2. And you will see then how many components I downloaded, I will show you. And as I said, if you cannot find it in the PCB libraries, then you need to ask them, or you can ask them to create the footprint for you. You will pay $5. There are more options, depends how complex the component is, but I paid $5 for all the for each of the 3 footprints what I needed. And then you need to pay $1 or $2 to download it from the database. So once the footprint is ready, you need to download it as the other standard components. So let's have a look on this software, how it looks and how you can find the components in the libraries, how you can download it. To download the software, just click on this builder icon which is here, or you can go directly on this URL. The software what we need is called Pod Builder, okay? So when you are downloading, be sure it's called Download Free Pod Builder. Click here, download the file and install the software. It is very easy to install the software. It's like agree with the agreement and then next and finish or something like this. It's very simple. When you start the software, this is how it looks. And if you would like to see some sample footprints, go into library editor, and here is the sample library. If you cannot see this sample library, go to this open directory or open library icon. And inside of the directory where the software is installed, you will find this sample library. Select open. To check how these footprints look, you can just select a component, for example, this one. Now, right click, view selected footprint, left click, and this is how it looks. Let's say we would like to download footprint and ideally also 3D model of this Qualcomm chip. So I'm going to copy manufacturer part number. I go on PCB Library's website, click on parts, search, select the manufacturer, so we need Qualcomm chip, and put here the part number. Click on search pot, and they have it. So to get the footprint and 3D model for this chip, you pay $1 basically. To be able to download this footprint, you need to register and you need to buy pod credit. The registration is quite simple. To buy the credit, I need to say the lowest credit what you can buy is $50. So you need to pay at least $50. And it took some time to actually assign this credit to my account. I'm not sure if it was like specific problem, but it took a couple of hours to actually assign the credit to my account, and only after these couple of hours I was able to buy this footprint. So once you have credit, you need to be logged in, and then you will be able to download this. I'm going to show you how it works. I'm going to log in. Now I'm logged in, and you can see I can download the footprint and 3D step file of this chip. And you can see the file what we will download, it is FBX file. So when you download it, it looks like this. And then you basically can open this file in the special software. I'm going to open this, click on open library, and here is the file what we have downloaded. Click on open. This is the file. If you would like to see the footprint, right click, view selected footprint, and ta-da, footprint for our Qualcomm chip. Once I have the footprint imported, there are a couple of settings what I normally adjust. So if you like, you can download the software and you can go through all the settings and have a look what you can change. But usually I go to terminal, density level, and because I'm designing a board with very high density of the components, I change this to least. It will make the footprint a little bit smaller or smallest as it can be. And then I go into draftings, and I change some of the parameters for a legend and assembly. So outline width, I usually use 0.2 millimeter. That's the thickness of the outline seal screen or outline lines which are around the components. You need to press OK to apply this. And also, usually when I adjust the mask, I will speak about mask a little bit later in this video. When I adjust the mask, I don't want to have it very close to this seal screen. So I also adjust the clearance, how close this seal screen can go. And I will change this to 0.22. Enter, and notice when I press OK, notice this will be a little bit smaller. See? And also I adjust the assembly drawing layer, so outline width, I will change this to 0.2. Enter. OK. When you need to create a footprint with pin 1 marking, you may want to also check this. So for the chip, we would like to see where pin 1 is located. So I'm going to check it here, and also I'm going to check this here and press OK. See what changed? And something has not changed. Can you see it? On the assembly layer, this corner is cut it. So that's okay, but on this legend layer, on the seal screen, there is no really pin one marking. I'm not really sure why. Maybe I'm doing something wrong. You know, I'm not professionally or expert in using in this software, so maybe there is a setting what I forgot to set. But as you can see, there is no pin one marking on the seal screen layer as we have it right now. And I would like to speak a little bit about this pin one marking, because it's quite interesting topic. If we go back into this document, you will notice the pin one location is usually recommended on bottom left corner for this kind of components. And as you can see in this new standard, seal screen polarity marking, they recommend to mark it the way they remove this piece of line where pin 1 is located. I'm not very happy about using something like this, because very often when these components are manually soldered, people are using these corners to correctly place the components on the PCB. And if I start removing these lines, it can kind of make these manual components placement a little bit more complicated. So I really, really prefer using the circle to mark pin one location rather than using these lines. And also notice they placed pin one on the bottom left corner, which is kind of, again, something what I'm not really sure if that's a great idea, because for many components, pin one is located actually on top left corner. So this is kind of, it can be sometimes confusing, and it can bring some kind of possible mistakes in footprints. So in my footprints, I keep using pin one location in top left corner. If you go into different documents like this one, I will attach a link to this document so you can have a look. This document, I think it is based on different kind of standards. And here you can find information how this pin one location is recommended for different kind of components. And I'm not sure how old is this document. I don't know. But I really like the recommendation which are here. And as you can see, they keep using, or they keep recommending pin one location in upper left corner for all these kind of components. If you would like to rotate this pin one location here in this software, it's very simple. So you can just simply go here and select this up. Okay, and now we have pin one located in top left corner. So this is something what we would like to import into our CAD system, or something what we would like to export, and then we would like to import it into Altium. Let's do it. To export the footprint and 3D model from this software, just click on this icon here. In this list, you can select all the kind of different CAD systems. I'm using Altium, so I will select Altium Designer. This is the output directory, and what I really love about this software, you can actually select the layers which you would like to use during the export. So the assembly outline layer is going to be placed automatically on the layer which you use for all your other components as assembly outline layer. You can specify where the seal screen is going to be placed, the reference designator. So this is very, very useful. Once you set it up, you can just save it, and then these layers will be automatically used next time when you will be doing the export. I also selected that I would like to export 3D model. So here are few settings. I just left them default. And once you set up everything, then just simply press create and close. When we have a look what was generated, we will find three files. One of them is a step file, so this is the 3D model, and these files are basically the, or it is basically the script which we are going to import, or which we are going to use to import this footprint into Altium Designer. If you are not sure how to import these files into your CAD system, then when you will be doing export, so in this menu which is here, click on this user guide button. It will open a specific help page based on this CAD system which you select here. It will open the user guide. Oops, I didn't want to do this. It will open the user guide, for example, how to import these files into Altium Designer. So when I click here, this is the page what will open. Okay, and here is a video which will explain you how to import the script or how to open the script in Altium. If I selected Allegro, this is the page what was opened when I clicked on the user guide button. So it describes how to import the component into Allegro. To import the footprint into Altium, this is what we need to do. Open Altium, go to File, Run Script, click on Browse, from File, find where the script is located. So this is the script. Open, select it here, and click OK. Now, I'm not sure why, but this library, it is kind of weird. For example, when I double click on this path, there is no properties panel. I cannot see properties of this path. If I select this, no properties. If I double click, I don't know, here, no properties. If I go down here and click on this panels button, there is no properties panel here. And because I'm not sure what are the default settings for this automatically generated library from the script, what I normally do, I copy and paste this footprint into my own libraries. So for example, in this video we can create a new library. Click on File, New Library, PCB Library. This is what I would do. I create a new library, okay, I will save it, right click, save as, and I'm going to save it, let's say, somewhere here. I'm going to call it same name as the footprint, save it. So this is going to be our new library. Now I go back into the library which was generated by the script, and I simply right click on the footprint, copy. I go into my new library, or you can go here, and right click, paste one component. Okay, so now we have this new footprint in our new library. And now when I double click on this path, have a look. See? We have the properties panel. If I go down here, there is the properties panel. If I double click here, here are properties of all the paths and lines and everything. Okay, I don't know why it doesn't work here. I have no idea. Everything what we need to add here is 3D model, because by default, if I go into 3D mode, see, there is no 3D model. So click on place 3D body. I go and I'm going to find, oops, I'm going to find the 3D model what we have exported from the software. Here is the step file, open and place it. What I really like about the 3D models which are generated from this software, they are automatically correctly centered and automatically the pin 1 location is correct, the height is correct, I mean the placement on the PCB is correct. You just place it, you don't need to manipulate with the 3D objects trying to place it directly on the pads and all this stuff. It is automatically very nicely generated, so you can very simply place the 3D model on the footprint. We can now close the library which was created during the import, so I'm going to close this. And this is our footprint. If we go into the directory, so this is our new library with the footprint what we have created. We use these files to run the script and create the footprint automatically, and this is the step file what we have used in our new footprint. When we go back into our library, I'm going to delete the default component. And if you cannot see all the layers, don't forget to go into view configuration or press L on your keyboard and double check if you can see all the layers. We are going to have a look on the layers what we have imported from the software. Press Shift S, go into single layer mode, go on top layer, and first thing what we need to adjust is the mask or top solder mask layer around the pads. If I zoom in, if I go on top solder, you see the opening for top solder mask has exactly same size as the pad. I'm not really sure why this software is not setting up the mask a little bit different way. I would expect to maybe follow some recommendations, maybe make the mask a little bit bigger. So always when I imported the footprint, I had to go here, select all the parts and adjust the mask size. I'm going to change this to 0.04 millimeter. Okay. The next layer is the bottom layer. There is nothing on the bottom layer. Next one is mechanical one. This is where we have 3D model. And then there is mechanical 12 layer. If we go into the library expert software, we can see that we exported on mechanical layer 12, we exported their terminal outline and component outline. So this is correct. Mechanical 15, it is courtyard outline, and mechanical 29, this is the assembly layer, I guess. So 29, it is assembly outline layer, and also the reference designator is on mechanical 29 layer. Perfect. And the next one is top overlay. On the top overlay layer, we would like to have pin 1 somehow marked. And as you can see on mechanical 29 layer or on the assembly drawing, the pin 1 is marked automatically from the import, but on this one I would expect maybe something like this. I'm not sure why it is not imported automatically or created by the software, but I really prefer the circle, so I'm going to draw the circle. I'm in millimeters. I will set the grid to 0.1, click on place, circle. And I'm going to do it maybe like this. Okay. Bottom overlay, there is nothing. Top paste. Notice, and I really like this, the paste layer for this exposed part, it automatically, or the software automatically created these multiple openings for this exposed part in the paste layer, and that's really great. Bottom paste, there is nothing. Top solder, and basically that's everything what we need. Of course, this footprint as we have it here now, it's still, we cannot still say like it's finished, because why? Do you know why? You still should check the footprint, and you still should download the data sheet and have a look if they don't have recommended footprint. For example, when I was creating the components for my project, and when I was using this library expert software, I found out very often, for example, for BGA footprints, I had to adjust the size of the parts on the BGA footprint. I had to adjust the solder mask on the around the parts, and you know, it's maybe not perfect, but it can save some time. And I'm pretty sure the $1 what I spent for this, what we created, it's worth it. And also when I asked to create the other footprints, which I was not able to download, and they created these footprints and 3D models for $5. And in the meantime, I could do something else. I could work on schematic, for example. Again, for me, it was worth it. So even if this software will not create like super perfect footprints, you still may need to check the footprint, you still may need to adjust the footprint, but it is worth to pay for this, what you get from the software, for the 3D model and for the initial footprint. It is worth for me. That's what I wanted to say. As you know, as I said, I'm not expert in using this software, so maybe you may want to go through some of the settings. Maybe you will find out why this pin 1 is not marked in the footprint. I actually contacted Tom, and I wanted to have a call before I created this video, because I wanted to go through some settings, and I wanted to be sure I will explain everything correctly in the video. They told me they are preparing a new solution in the next year, and they would like to have a call maybe next year. But, you know, I wanted to create this video right now, so I'm sorry I couldn't provide the complete perfect solution with all the settings and everything for this software. But I still believe what you can see in this video, it can help you and it can save you some time. Because, as I said, I spent maybe one day trying to figure out how it works and playing with this software around and testing different footprints. So, yeah. I really enjoyed creating this video because I learned a lot of new stuff. And I can tell you that when I decided to start creating my new library, based on the new IPC standard, I spend a lot of time trying to find how to create so simple footprint like 0201 footprint for simple resistor. I couldn't find anything. I searched for data sheet. I found some data sheet, but there was no information about the footprint with these rounded corners or anything. It was, I spent a lot of time looking for information how to create this simple 0201 footprint for resistor, and I end up using this software, and this software just speed up my project. And this is not advertisement, okay? I really found this software useful. I found it by myself. I paid for all the footprints which I use in my project, and by the way, here are the footprints what I use in my project. So for 27 footprints, I spend almost all my $50. So it's like $2 average for a footprint. And these are just footprints what I used. Maybe some of them I use multiple times. So I have much more components in my project, but these are all the footprints which are basically used in my project. So $50 for all the footprints for my project with 80 types of components what I have there. That's not bad. Okay, so that's everything for my today's video. If you like, have a look on this software. Let me know what do you think. Let me know what do you think about the standards. I'm really curious to know what do you think about the marking pin 1, position of the pin 1. What do you think about these rounded corners and rectangle parts, why it was changed. And let me know if you have any experience with this library expert or maybe some other companies what also create footprints and how much it costs. Because I just may use this kind of services in future because I found it useful and maybe even like worth it. Okay, so if you like this video, please don't forget press like button and thank you very much for watching. See you next time. Bye.